So now let's take a look at the definition of mechanical ventilation and the need for mechanical ventilation in buildings. These are various illustrations of the different types, components of mechanical systems that you will witness in a building, starting from window, ACs, different components of ducts, various sizes, commercial kitchens, kitchen exhaust, basement exhaust systems, and terrace plant rooms. So, what is mechanical ventilation? It is the use of mechanical air handling systems, also referred to as heating, ventilation, and air conditioning systems, to ventilate buildings. Normally, they are used when natural ventilation is not happening by default, and we need to support the ventilation with mechanical means. So most commercial buildings use mechanical ventilation, which is more controllable and responsive than natural ventilation in providing adequate indoor air quality. So when the comfort indoor conditions cannot be achieved by natural means, by designing the building with that intent, we have to support it with mechanical means. It is recommended in all cases where satisfactory standard of ventilation, both in respect of quantity and quality, cannot be obtained by natural means. Now let us enlist or look at various instances where mechanical ventilation has to be provided in buildings. The first aspect would be the climatic zone in which the building is located. There are places with extreme climatic conditions where the indoors has to be maintained at comfort levels, so we need to adopt mechanical means. Siting or orientation of the building is an important aspect because solar heat gain based on the cardinal directions north, south, west, east, and subsequently high outside temperatures can add to the heat load within the building, which becomes quite significant and cannot be supported by natural means. So this external solar heat gain also is added on to by the internal heat gain that is released from the occupants, from the equipment and various processes indoors. The user comfort level is another consideration. So the people who are using the building need to have that optimum temperature level, humidity level, air velocity, air movement to remain comfortable indoors. So this becomes another factor for consideration. Next, the building form or the shape. When we design too deep a building plate, a floor plate, it becomes difficult to ventilate the internal spaces of the building because they remain away from the peripheral walls and they do not have access to the outdoor air or light. Local air quality is poor in instances where the building is located on a busy road with heavy vehicular traffic, which give out a lot of exhaust and carbon, or there are building uses around the building which contribute to contaminating the air. That is another time when we adopt mechanical ventilation. Sometimes the local noise levels, the outdoor noise levels, are very high, similar to the previous instance where the building is located near a heavy traffic zone. So windows cannot be opened, then we need to ventilate it mechanically. The local urban structure is very dense and shelters the building from wind. So when you have city centers, those dense city areas where the buildings are contiguous, or the setbacks have been very minimal and do not assist in good aeration. Privacy or security requirements do not allow windows being opened or provision of windows itself, right? So say for instance, bank locker zones, secure zones. So these are some of the aspects. Further, internal plan of the building has many internal partitions. So from one space to another, there is no proper circulation of air. Density of occupation. Say a building is heavily occupied. For example, consider an auditorium with the capacity of 500 to 1000. You cannot have windows there, but you need to enclose it, yet keep the internal air comfortable and safe. So that is where you need a mechanical system. There are buildings with some kind of manufacturing processes happening, lots of equipments in usage, computer labs, which give out a lot of heat, lighting, and so on. These create heavy or high heat loads and also sometimes contribute to the contamination of the air. And then lastly, why we need mechanical ventilation? Because by design, by architectural design, the project doesn't, the project or the space doesn't allow natural ventilation default. Like ICUs in hospitals, certain labs which are conducting experiments, chemical biohazards, which require controlled environments. There are museums which display artifacts, and these artifacts have to be protected from humidity, high temperatures. So there has to be a controlled indoor environment at all times. So these are some of the reasons on why mechanical ventilation is adopted or needed in buildings. Now, this is a term which we might have come across at certain stages, sick building syndrome. Now to the right, you see some of the parameters of keeping a building healthy. So we are considering the building as an organism, and like any other organism, it has to run in a safe, systematic, healthy manner. So what are the parameters? You can take a look at the points written there. Ventilation, air quality, thermal health, the moisture, right? Dust, pests, safety, security, water, noise, lighting. So various aspects. Also, you need to have active design for fire protection, for proper communication between different spaces. So what is a building which is not functioning to that optimum healthy condition? It gives rise to sick building syndrome. So it is a term that is used to describe the presence of acute non-specific symptoms in the majority of people who use the building and work in the building, lead with an adverse indoor environment. So the building is not having a good ventilation system, and it leads to certain specific symptoms in the people who are using it. And these symptoms are usually short-lived and experienced immediately after exposure to the indoor climate, indoor environment, and they disappear when one leaves the building. So it is very time-specific whenever the user is within the premises. So what it causes, or the causes for the sick building syndrome, that it could be flaws in the HVAC design, no proper fresh air coming in or exhausting the used air, contaminants such as volatile organic compounds, molds, improper exhaust ventilation of ozone because of the machinery that we use in offices, lack of adequate fresh air intake or air filtration. So these are some of the causes for a building becoming a host to sick building syndrome. And the symptoms that the person or the occupant senses or witnesses could be anything between irritation of the eyes, nose, throat, cause of fatigue, wheezing, sinus, skin irritation, sensitivity reactions to things, right? But these are very specific to the time spent within. It may disappear once you go out. Of course, prolonged exposure to sick building syndrome may turn the acute symptoms into chronic symptoms. So that is what we have to keep in mind, bear in mind that when we design an HVAC system for a building, it has to be kept in mind that it caters to safer, healthier parameters of comfort conditions. Now, ASHRAE, American Society of Heating, Refrigeration and Air Conditioning Engineers. The Indian counterpart is ISHRAE. They have a website and they have the standards in place, releasing at frequent intervals. All the standards are updated there, and globally the safety standards are followed for refrigeration systems and air conditioning systems. So we can always go to this website, and the latest one being the 2019. Of course, to 2020 and 2021 also, they have released standards for indoor ventilation systems post COVID era. So it is always better to keep updating ourselves with these. And then we also need to abide by the National Building Code of India 2016 being the latest one. So these two have to be frequently referred to for various standards of mechanical ventilation. Now, ACH, it means air changes per hour. We are continuing understanding of our ventilation in buildings. So, and this is one of the measures or parameters for measuring the ventilation rates, right? So, air changes per hour, very short form ACH or AC per hour. It is a measure of the air volume added to or removed from a space divided by the volume of the space. So, N is equal to 60, Q by the volume. N refers to the number of air changes per hour, Q the volumetric flow rate of air in cubic feet per minute. Volume, we refer to the room dimensions or the volume of the room, length by width by height. These air change rates are often used as rules of thumbs in ventilation design. There are standard prescriptions of ACH given by ASHRAE that we can follow for specific spaces. So air changes per hour is simply the number of times of the air in a room that has to be replaced with completely new volume of air in 1 hour. So you have a given space or a room, and there is air inside the room which is used by the occupants, and it becomes a vitiated or used air. So this air has to be replaced by a completely new volume of fresh air in given 1 hour. So that is simply put the definition of ACH. A value of 5 air changes per hour means a room's entire volume of air is replaced with new air 5 times in 1 hour. So this is a measure of quantifying the ventilation in a given room. Now this is ASHRAE recommended air changes per hour for common building types. Let us see some examples. So for homes, the suggested outdoor air ventilation rate, that is air changes per hour, outdoor air replacing the indoor air, 0.35 to 1. Hotel rooms 1 to 2, offices 2 to 3, retail shops 2 to 3, schools 5 to 6, because the occupancy level, density of the occupancy is high. Sports facilities 4 to 8, restaurants 6 to 8. So these tables are prescribed for better indoor calibration by ASHRAE. You can also see it in the ASHRAE website. So doubling room occupancy doubles required ventilation rate. Simple as that. You increase the occupancy of people, you have to likewise increase the air changes per hour. Now this is another example of a table for a hospital area. So how much for critical and intensive care? Minimum prescribed is 2, total around 6. So outdoor, when we say total, it also means the mechanically purified air also, like in air conditioning. So you conditioned the used air with adding the outdoor air, so somewhere between 2 to 6. In isolation rooms, 2 to 12. So this was to the extent, post-COVID-19, these were revised. So examination rooms between 2 to 6. So you can refer to these ACH tables given by, prescribed by ASHRAE. Now there is another measure of ventilation. It is called as ventilation rates, expressed as volume rate per person. The conversion between air changes per hour, ACH that we saw previously, and ventilation rate per person is as follows. So that is a formula which is based on air changes per hour, occupant density, and the height of the space. So this is a conversion factor of adopting ventilation rates after having the ACH value available with us. So both of these are used as measures of ventilation, and while designing have to be abided by. Moving on to the next segment, types of mechanical ventilation available. Largely speaking, we can have 3 types: exhaust only, supply only, and balanced. So exhaust only is when you are exhausting or removing the used air. Supply only, supplying only fresh air. Balanced, you use both exhaust and supply. Each system uses a combination of fans, ducts, dampers, and controls, and they each have different pros, cons, and costs accompanying them. So in this particular session, we will look at 6 types of mechanical ventilation systems, beginning with the most fundamentally used system, ceiling fan, exhaust fan, also called as vacuum system, local exhaust ventilation system called as LEVs, supply ventilation or positive system, combined or balanced, and evaporative cooling system. All right. So let us begin with the first one, the ceiling fans. So we all have used this at every point in our lives, the most basic fundamental mechanical system. It is effective only over a certain limited area of air distribution, right? So it is hung from the ceiling or freestanding or on the wall. The impact is to a limited area. Ideal ceiling height would be 3 meters, not above that, because the air circulation might not reach the occupancy level. Wall mounted fans are effective to create air movement in horizontal direction. So it will actually help in providing the circulation in the occupancy zone. They circulate air within a room for the purpose of reducing the perceived temperature because of evaporation of perspiration on the skin of the occupants. So once the hot air rises, it goes up. Ceiling fans may be used to keep a room warmer in the winter by circulating the warm stratified air back from the ceiling to the floor. So this is something that is also possible with ceiling fans. In summers, you use it to create the feeling of cool indoors. In winters, you can reverse it and use it to warm up. So choosing whether the blades spin clockwise or counterclockwise makes a difference in the temperature of the air that your home or office receives. Now there are various typologies or advancements that have happened in ceiling fans, right? You even have something to the effect of Bluetooth enabled fans inducing music or anything to that effect, lamps, lights, etc. We'll just see some briefly some of them. There are fans with remote control and light kit included. There are Wi-Fi enabled smart fans, Alexa enabled with different lighting modes for different modes, and remote access also. Suppose you go out of your house and you remember that you haven't switched off the fan, it is at the click of your phone. There are very uniquely designed fans which do not look like fans. Antique looks, etc. The next type would be exhaust fans. These are also very commonly used in our residences or offices, but they have larger application as well, up to the industrial level. So what they do is mechanical extract and natural supply. So two phases for this. So you are mechanically removing the air from the space, right? But seeing that replaced air is by natural means. So that is the mode of operation in an exhaust system. Again, it's quite simple. The fans could be propeller, axial or mixed flow type. Normally you need a outside wall or a ventilator to exhaust the indoor air, or large scale plants, or you can use the roof also to place the exhaust fans. So the basic principle on which exhaust fan work, by sucking hot humid air out of a small localized area. So essentially you have to remove the hot air from the inside, but allowing the fresh air to enter via a window or ventilator or a vent in order to replace it. The warm air that's drawn out using an exhaust fan is then pulled through a ducting system and expelled outside. So we must have seen our kitchen exhausts where you have the hood and the duct takes the exhausted air out of the house. It is commonly used in baths, kitchens, laundries. You must have seen the range hoods over cooktops and kitchens. They are also adopted in factories, offices and public halls when they are of larger capacity, heavy duty fans. Relatively simple and inexpensive to install and low running cost as well. So what is the sketch indicating? So we have the exhaust fan here in the attic, the negative pressure inside, positive outside. You are getting the fresh air through inlets. The used air is sucked in through the ducts and exhausted by the outlet. It's a very simple mechanism. So typically an exhaust ventilation system is composed of a single fan that you can see in the attic, connected to a centrally located single exhaust point in the house. A preferable design option is to connect the fan to the ducts from various rooms. So you see these ducts where the air is entering the exhaust system. So this is a sketch of a kitchen exhaust. What happens? The hood arrests the warm air or the used air And there are filters, activated carbon grease filters, which arrest the impurities in the air, the carbon or anything that is dispersed in the air. Then the fan is here, bifurcated eggshell fan, which creates a suction for the used air to flow to it, and it is thrown via extract air to the outside. Very simple mechanism, but you need to have the right capacity of exhaust fan selected and the right design of this hood and the duct. So residential exhaust fan needs to run continuously and achieve a minimum of 5 air changes per hour for the kitchen area to remove the heat, to remove the carbon, to remove the odor. And these are called as electric chimneys, very commonly used. These are large exhaust systems that are adopted for heavy-duty exhaustion in buildings, high-rise buildings, or factories and industries. The third type, local exhaust ventilation systems, called as LEVs. So these are normally adopted in instances as seen here in factories where there are works like welding, right, adopted for manufacturing purposes. So the heat generated in industrial buildings can be removed at the source itself, so that is the intent, by using LEV before the airborne contaminants spread into the surrounding environment. So the intent is very clear. In manufacturing processes, the contaminated air has to be arrested at the point of generation itself. Now let us see how that happens. These are some of the images where these are the hoods where the contaminants are arrested at the point of work. These are also quite economically viable, effective. They remove the harmful contaminants at the source itself before they disperse. If possible, the source space may be enclosed and exhaust system provided suitably. Once the contaminated air is exhausted, fresh air has to be introduced by natural or mechanical means. That is taken that once you exhaust the used vitiated air, it has to be the space has to be replaced with fresh, clean air. Now let us see the various parts of a LEV. So basically 5 main parts. 1, the hood that has to capture the contaminant at the source. So you see the hood here, if you can see my pointer. Ducts for transporting the air. So ducts are those linear elements that transport air from one point to another. So from the hood, the air has to go to the exhaust fan. The hood is here. It's a flexible hood in the second picture and a rigid hood in the first diagram. Third one, an air cleaning device that removes or minimizes the contaminants. So you might have a component of a filtration suitably provided to clean the air. A fan that moves the air through the system that creates the required suction power. And an exhaust stack through which the contaminated is discharged to the outdoor. So these are the main components of a LEV. And you might have to draw the sketch and describe the components and the functioning when asked. The fourth type of mechanical ventilation that we will look at is supply or positive ventilation system. It is the opposite of exhaust ventilation that we have seen earlier. So how does a supply ventilation system work? It works by pressurizing the building. So if you see, we are maintaining a positive pressure inside the building. So it is the opposite of exhaust ventilation system. So how is this made possible? We are going to have a fan, a central supply fan, to force or to suck in the outside air into the building. Okay, so the outside fresh air is mechanically sucked into the building or introduced into the building by the placement of a supply fan. This also is relatively simple and inexpensive, similar to the exhaust system, and the overall system will include a fan of the appropriate capacity, and a duct system that introduces fresh air into usually one or several rooms. So in the sketch, if you see, we're witnessing three rooms or three compartments, and there has to be a way of introducing the airflow between the spaces by giving vents or louvers between the partition walls. And finally, what happens here is we are going to have a central fan. In this case, it is in the attic. It could be in the false ceiling also. So what the fan does is create the suction to get in the fresh air from the outside into the building. So we are keeping the indoors at high pressure. Okay, and how do we exhaust? By mechanical, not mechanical, that is by placement of ventilators, by natural means. So the heavier exhausted air is taken out at the ventilator level. By pressurizing the house, the supply ventilation systems discourage the entry of pollutants from outside the living space and prevent the backdraft of combustion gases from fireplaces and appliances. So this is a positive aspect of supply ventilation system. The fifth type is a combined or balanced ventilation system. So it is going to adopt both the principles of exhaust and supply systems. It neither pressurizes nor depressurizes. It introduces and exhausts approximately equal quantities of fresh air and polluted air respectively. So we are going to use air changes per hour in suitable quantities, wherein the quantity of fresh air introduced and the used air exhausted is approximately similar. So now what we have is two sets of fans, because mechanically introduction of fresh air and mechanically exhausting of used air is seen. So we need to get in the fresh air by supply fan, and it picks up the vitiated air and is forced through the exhaust fan to the outside. The system has two fans and two duct systems, naturally, one for the fresh air and the other for exhausting. It facilitates good distribution of fresh air by placing supply and exhaust vents in appropriate places. You need to design the both the ends of the system appropriately. Of course, since the number of fans and the ducts increased, it is expensive compared to the other two types to install and operate as well. It prevents infiltration of dust and other airborne contaminants into the space, because we are maintaining positive pressure and exhausting it via the negative pressure. So quick view of the same, where we have supply fan in the embedded false floor and the exhaust fan in the attic or the false ceiling. So you need to pump in the fresh air mechanically and exhaust the used air mechanically as well. The last type is the evaporative cooling system. They are very similar to the concept or principles used in desert coolers or swamp coolers. It works on the principle that when air passes over a wet surface or water, it picks up the moisture and it itself gets cooled. So that is the principle used here. The hot air, when forced through wet surface, absorbs water and becomes cooler. It is adopted in hot regions and avoided in humid regions. Dry fresh air from the outdoors is circulated through a wet pad where it absorbs the moisture as water vapor. Alright, so after that the air exits the building through the grills or open windows. Let us see an illustration of the same ahead. Normally these evaporative coolers are located on the roof. But there are possibilities of through wall coolers also. Whenever you do not have the facility of the roof, we can have in a through wall coolers as well. So essentially, what do we expect when we are using a evaporative cooling system? In this case, it is a floor mounted evaporative cooler, and the fresh air enters the space and maybe exhausted mechanically or naturally. So when the outdoor air is at 41 degrees and the relative humidity is a low 10%, evaporative cooling can produce indoor air at 26 degrees and 50% relative humidity with the power necessary to operate a fan. So very advantageous in dry arid regions where you can lower the temperature and increase the relative humidity to comfort level. So this is what happens when you use a evaporative cooler, and the power consumption is just about enough to operate a fan. So this is an example of a rooftop system. So we are looking at the slabs in a section. This is the casing of the evaporative cooling system. So the air is going to enter through the screen. It could have louvers also, and it is going to pass through an absorptive pad. The pad is a porous lightweight material which is sprayed with water constantly. The air picks up the moisture, becomes cooler, and the fan is going to thrust or force the air to the indoors. So if you see to the right, the hot air passing through the wet pad, you need to have a jet spray of water on the pad, and the water is going to get collected in the water reservoir or tray. To the left also you have seen that, and this has to be constantly cleaned or water removed from the tray. This cool refreshing air enters through the blower into the space. Just to sum up now, this is a very popular building, Centre Pompidou Paris, where you have seen most of these mechanical ventilation services on the outer skin of the building. So as an exercise, you can look at this case study and understand how the services are exposed to the outside and how they're color coded. You can see the exhaust fans, the ducts, right? So it makes a good case study. So as an exercise to end this particular segment of understanding of mechanical ventilation, you can discuss the revised standards for mechanical ventilation as per ASHRAE standards to counteract the COVID-19 spread, and describe the various types of mechanical ventilation systems suitable for various typologies of buildings such as residential, institutions, industries, hotels, etc. So this would increase your understanding of what mechanical type to adopt in which kind of building. It is subjective. It is based on various aspects like the outdoor air quality, the client requirements, the possibility of access to this equipment, manpower to install these, and also the financial constraint. So that ends the module component for mechanical ventilation in buildings. Thank you.